The sun shines on the stars of the color purple. An upfront look at the question of love and the musical genius of Quincy Jones. All this and more today on Essence.
Susan Taylor, welcome to Essence.
And I'm Phillipe Luciano. Today's show revolves around one of the most talked about movies of the season, The Color Purple.
When it was released, its visual and emotional impact was breathtaking, controversial, and immediate.
Now we'll recapture some of the magical moments so masterfully adapted from Alice Walker's Pulitzer Prize-winning novel.
And to guide us are some of the key players who gave life to the images both behind and in front of the cameras.
The first thing that attracted me to it was simply the character of Celia, and the fact that I kept thinking, my goodness, this is a movie about a prisoner in a free world. She helps to escape this life, and that attracted me. But it was the writing of the book, it was the feelings that Alice had put into these people that got to me, and I kept saying, but I'm not black, why am I crying? And I said that when I was reading the book, why do I have tears in my eyes? I'm not black. This must not be a question of race, this must be a question of humanity.
Woman that should have been your mammy.
Should Avery?
Oh, come on. Give me a hand and get in the house.
The ability to love was important for me in terms of Mr. Figuratively and literally, he couldn't imagine or he couldn't realize what he wanted. That's how I was able to get to the other parts of it. So the anger, the hostility, the brutality came out of that. The sense of being unloved, perhaps.
It is a fictional story that Alice has written to tell her story. She's talking about women, she's not talking about men. And if there ever was a time that we had to take the same considerations with depiction. That's why I was glad when Steven, 3 months into the project, said, look, Alice Walker, as a black writer, can write like this, what she feels, because it's a one-on-one a relationship with the reader, and it's her feelings as a black writer to do this. But if you put that same feeling on the screen, and put the identical same feeling on the screen with no redeeming features with any of the male characters, it plays into the hands of racism. That's the first thing he saw.
Look like you got yourself in trouble.
No, sir, I ain't in no trouble. Big though.
Who the daddy?
Hoppo.
How he know that?
He know because he the only one.
Sophia is a woman who's born before her time. I wish she could have been around now. She is a combination of all the women that I think I've crossed over on to get to this side. She's Sojourner Truth, and she's Harriet Tubman, and Fannie Lou Hamer, and all the women, black women, who have gone unnamed. Your grandmother and my grandmother and aunts and sisters of ours who didn't get their name in history books, but who were part of the struggle. And I think that part of the joy for me of bringing Sophia to life and being a part of this purple experience is that I know all of those sisters who've gone on before me are rejoicing. They're rejoicing because that's what that struggle was all about.
But it was a very important message to get across that people have to sort of fight for who they are. They have to present themselves, sometimes with a grand struggle. And Celia's helped make that presentation through all of these wonderful people who come into her lives and teach her, sort of re-educate her to the ways of the world and to life.
I was surrounded by people who made you want to be brilliant, all telling each other how brilliant they thought each other were. Now, you get that much energy going, and you can't be anything but good.
Friend of the family, fix up the spare room.
I can't move. I need to see her eyes. I feel like once I see her eyes, then my feet can let go of the spot they're stuck in. You sure is ugly. There's no stars on this movie. This was all a bunch of folks hanging loose, doing what they do best. What a gift, you know? Who knows if it'll ever be like that again? You know, but what a way to start, you know?
I'm Quincy Jones, and music is a very important part of my life, but there's more, and I'll share it with you next one. Yes.
Welcome back to Essence. For today's Celebrity Spotlight, we'll take a look at musical genius Quincy Jones. For him, The Color Purple was a dream come true. For the first time in his career, he not only wrote the score, but was one of the film's producers as well. His commitment to excellence was very much in keeping with the way he's approached his astounding musical career, which has been going strong for more than four incredible decades. Celebrities are always eager to work with Quincy Jones, the producer with the golden touch. His creativity has spanned all aspects of the entertainment industry. Hey, hey, hey. Quincy Jones has composed film scores for over 35 motion pictures, starting in the 60s with The Pawnbroker, followed by In the Heat of the Night, They Call Me Mr. Tibbs, and The Wiz. He's also composed themes for over seven television series, including Sanford and Son and Ironside, and the musical score for the acclaimed miniseries Roots. Quincy Jones has released 23 albums under his own name, and he's also arranged, produced, and conducted for the biggest names in music, ranging from Ella Fitzgerald to Peggy Lee, from Duke Ellington to Frank Sinatra. Quincy was a teenager when he and Ray Charles formed a band in Seattle. At 13, he wrote a composition for Count Basie. At 14, he played trumpet for Billy Eckstine. He shared with me how these early experiences helped shape his musical career.
You have to be crazy to be into music and think that that's what you can do all of your life anyway. Now it makes much more sense than it did then, because everybody would say, why don't you get a real job? Because nobody believed that there was a way it was possible to make a living in music. And when you first start out, you're not sure yourself, because you're not sure how good you're going to be. And it takes a long time to develop a craft and to get experience and learn different things and the things that have passed on. But I was lucky that people like Ray Charles and Count Basie and Dizzy Gillespie and Billy Eckstine and Bobby Tucker and people that believed and showed me the way.
In 1975, blood vessels on both sides of your brain ruptured. You weren't even expected to live. Did that brush with death change you?
The first thing I thought about when it was imminent that I might not be around anymore was, but I haven't done so-and-so, and I didn't do so-and-so, and this hasn't happened, and Kidada has never called me daddy, and she was 6 months old, and a lot of things come down real fast, and I didn't tell that person how I really feel about them, and I'm sorry that I did this. You know, it's a very strange, that thing about it, your whole life flashes quickly before you is very true. And there's some mechanism that goes off that triggers everything that you've, that's important to you in your life at that moment, because you know that may be it.
Since his operation, Quincy has become busier than ever, especially in 1985 when he used his musical talent for a larger cause. Michael Jackson and Lionel Richie wrote We Are the World, And for Quincy, it was a chance to team up again with Michael, with whom he produced the best-selling album of all time, the Grammy Award-winning Thriller.
I'll try to make this short, but I think of 10 years ago today, being at Cedars-Sinai with my neurosurgeon fighting for me to be alive, and I'm happy he made it because this is the best present a 50-year-old could ever get.
It took 3 months to produce Thriller, but when Quincy and Michael heard the test pressing of the album, it was hardly what they expected.
Michael cried, you know, but it was very simple what happened. On an LP, when you're dealing with pop music and you have electronic bass and synthesizers and big bass drum sounds on it, it takes big grooves to hold all of that sound. We ignored physics, really, and said we're going to put 23 minutes and 24 minutes aside on, and we didn't want to cut the songs down. Billie Jean was about 2 minutes too long, and one of Rod Temperton's songs were too long. We ignored it because we had to deliver the master, and the record company was waiting, and it was a total disaster. I mean, it was just didn't work. You know, the sound was small and pinched and thin and everything, and Michael cried, and we went into the next room, and the guy from the record company was ready to break out the champagne and said, no, put that away, you know, it's not champagne time yet.
Not yet.
Not yet, no way. And so everybody took 2 days off, said go get good night's sleep. That's what we needed, it was 2 nights sleep to think. And then we came back in and we had 8 remixes to do because The Girl Is Mine was already out and mixed. And we took one tune a day and put it away.
You said you want to squeeze the juice out of life.
It means not taking it for granted that you're going to have one more day to do, get everything. It's just back to my same saying about one of these days I'll get to it. And you have to deal with it every day like it's going to be the last time. Every project, not like I'll do something better next time. I didn't give everything I've got. It's 150% every time. And it's a sickness in a way. And you can call it workaholic or whatever it is, but it's the only way I know is to give it up.
Welcome back. One underlying theme of The Color Purple was the strained relationships between men and women. The characters may have been fictitious, but the conflicts portrayed were real. Joining me on Upfront to discuss one of these real-life issues is sociologist Lyn Lewis. Dr. Lewis is best known for her no-nonsense approach to getting to the root of the issue. Welcome to Essence, Dr. Lewis.
Thank you, Phillipe.
All right. Dr. Lewis recently met with a group of men and women to sift through the myriad of problems we all tend to bring to relationships. And today we'll take a look at the 5 key issues that came out of that discussion. Who do we start with?
Let's begin with Brian.
Okay.
What I feel I bring to relationship in a negative sense is I sometimes tend to lack patience. All right. I like to nurture a relationship. I like to be supportive. I like to offer my assistance in any way possible. After doing that, if the person has not, in my eyes, made some type of forward progress, I can get real ugly.
Now, Dr. Lewis, what was not said is that Brian is an executive.
That's true.
And as an executive, he is the male, white American ideal. Specialization, long hours at the workplace, and development of his career. Why should we criticize him when that's the American ideal?
I don't think we should. I think Brian is to be commended, as any other male or female who fits his status. But the other thing we must realize is that oftentimes, when we pursue one or two aspects of our lives, other aspects would go lacking. And what I'm suggesting is that Brian is impatient in relationships because he hasn't seen that as a goal. Mm. Once he defines it as a goal and knows that impatience is a sign of immaturity in that area, he may be able to move from impatience to patience and move from underdevelopment to development. And I think that is indicative of many men and women who have said, I want to forego male-female relationships
and pursue other kinds of things. And it's just not typical of professional men or women. It is typical of others who pursue other types of goals.
Good enough. Now, Vicky has a problem that we often see today among women.
Fierce independence, which the independence to the extent of being selfish. Used to having my own way, domineering because I'm the eldest of five and I'm used to being in a, I guess the word is authoritarian position. Okay, it's great for work. You have leadership qualities and that's good, you know, it's good for that. For a relationship, it's bad for the give and take. And ultimately, either the man will cow down to that, and I cannot stomach that. I want a leader. So if I can say jump, and he says how high, then I'm turned off. So that ends it. Or if we have to battle, that's no good.
Now, Vicky again is an example of what happens to black women when they've reached a certain professional status. I think they neglect other areas of their lives, like emotional growth.
No doubt about it. One of the things I discussed with Vicky is that independence, as she realizes, is fine when it comes to economics. But when it comes to male-female relationships, we aren't talking about independence. We are then talking about interdependence. We're talking about reciprocity, give and take. And I think that women and men who have foregone pursuing male-female relationships must realize, particularly women, that men have a tremendous need to feel needed. All people
Absolutely.
Do, but particularly black men, because they're oppressed. There are a number of barriers up on them. And when we realize this, we feel comfortable in saying, I need you. I need to hug you. I need to kiss you. I need to talk to you.
Men need to be admired,
yes. Loved, liked, cared for, desired. And when we realize these things, we will also realize that it does not make us less of a person, less of a woman, or less of a man to say, I need you.
Our next panelist is another woman named Sandra.
I really have a burning desire to have a trust in a man. I mean, a real trust where, I mean, if he were to tell me that the moon were made of cheese, I'd reach for the crackers and not ask a question. I mean, I want it that way. I really do. But because I feel that is the quality of trust that I'm giving.
Sandra reminds me of the true believer, the woman who is a blind faith believer in a man. What is it about some women that sets themselves up for pain and failure in a relationship?
First of all, I think we need to realize that just being a black woman is painful in America. That's first and foremost. Second, oftentimes a woman is told very early in her childhood that men are not to be trusted, that you must become independent, assertive, self-sufficient, develop child care and home care responsibilities so as if this man leaves you, you are not alone and
you can
take care of yourself.
Business.
Exactly.
Yes.
So consequently, women tend to say, well, I was told that you can't trust him, so I'm not expected to trust him. And thus, they set themselves up in relationships for relationships to fail. And I think that's unfortunate. And at some point in time, we have to realize that we must trust.
Very good answer. Let's go to a woman called Alice.
I don't listen, number one, and I find a lot of men want me to listen to them.
Why don't you?
I don't want to.
Why not?
Because I don't, basically, based on my past experience, want anybody telling me what to do.
How do we end up so far removed, so far apart in our relationships, where women see themselves self-sufficient and fiercely independent, and women consider men unworthy of respect, admiration, and unworthy of advice?
I think too often some of that is transmitted during childhood. The mother and the father must be very careful about what they say in the presence of children.
About men and other men in the family.
Precisely, precisely. Oftentimes that daughter may hear her mother speaking negatively about the father and then internalize that and say, I cannot trust men. Mm-hmm. I will not respect men. Alice is a classic example of a woman who clearly shows what happens when a woman does not respect black men. She says, I don't listen. She says, I don't want him telling me what to do. To not listen is to say what he has to say is not important.
Very good. Let's go to our final panelist, a man named Kefra.
The problems that I have brought to my serious relationships with women have been lust, pure unbridled lust, leading to leading to sexual infidelities.
Here's a very interesting study of a man who is afraid of intimacy, because that's what this lustful thing is about. Doesn't want to get too close to anybody. How do you explain that type of behavior?
A number of things are going on with that. First of all, lust for an adult speaks to some degree of immaturity when it comes to sexuality, when it comes to male-female relationships.
But is lust real? Is it a real emotion?
Lust is very real to that person who is lusting,
mm-hmm.
quite real. But I think what we have to recognize is a person who lusts is one who does not have enough control over his total self or her total self, and then more importantly, the sex self.
Doesn't build a long erotic relationship.
Exactly.
It's quick and spontaneous
exactly.
all the time.
And then oftentimes people think that lusting is safe.
Yes.
If I lust, then I don't worry about being hurt, being rejected, trying to cultivate a meaningful, long-lasting, enduring relationship. And basically, I can come and go as I please.
Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am.
Precisely.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lewis. Next week, we'll continue this discussion with an issue that all of us face, our sexuality. We'll be back right after this.
Thanks for joining us today.
And we look forward to your visiting us again. I'm Phillipe Luciano.
And I'm Susan Taylor. And we'll see you right here next week on Essence. Bye.
It's only beginning. We've only just touched what we can be. It's our time.
Essence is brought to you in part by Betty Crocker, the premier maker of quality desserts. By Coca-Cola, the makers of Coca-Cola and Sprite. And by Carson Products, the makers of Dark and Lovely. Ah, the pleasure of Dark and Lovely.
It's your turn. Go find one.